Welcome to the QFTest support video, how to handle a component not found exception. In this video, I'm going to demonstrate how you could analyze component not found exceptions efficiently without many side effects or impacts on other tests. The first video shows a simple test case, and the second video of the series will show a more complex way of such component troubles. All concepts and ideas which I'm going to share to you now can be applied to any supported technology, which means either Java Swing or Java FX or Java SWT or even web applications. Okay, then let's start. So here we have a simple test case of our demo application, the JCar Configurator application. The simple test case is going to create a new accessory piece, which we will then see in this kind of table on the left-hand side. The test case worked in previous versions of the Car Configurator application, and we expect the test case to work in that new version, which we can see in the title bar here, as well as it did for the previous ones. So let's select the test case and let's run the test case via pressing start test 1. And what we see actually is that the test case doesn't run through smoothly. At the end of the test case, we get an error box telling us that something went wrong during our test run. And now let's go to analyze what's wrong. In order to find what's the root cause of this exception, we can use the runlog of QFTest, which we can simply open via pressing show runlog from that error box. So I'm pressing that button and QFTest opens the runlogs for me. Now, in that runlog, I can use the toolbar button find next error from the topmost toolbar in order to jump to the first exception text, which I'm going to press now, and QFTest immediately jumped to that exception, and we see that we are facing a component not found exception with the message the target component accessory price could not be determined. Our first step is actually to check whether we can find the component on the screenshots, which we also get automatically created in this error situation. Therefore, I select a screenshot of our accessory dialog, and we can see that we see the price field on that screenshot. If we take a look at our sequence, which has been replayed, we see that a name has been entered, ACC1, that an ID has been entered, S99, and entering the price was actually the step which was failing. But as the name and the ID field were there, we actually expect the price field to be there as well. So what I would like to do now I would like to analyze the tests step by step. Therefore, I select the node which is actually having this kind of exception, and I open the context menu using the right mouse click, and I select the first entry, find node in test suite. If I select this action, QFTest automatically jumps from the runlog to the test suite, and it's automatically selecting the corresponding node, which we can see here. Once we have selected that failing node, I do set a breakpoint on that node now using the context menu again and selecting breakpoint on off or control 8 F8 on the keyboard. So I'm selecting this guy and I get a breakpoint created automatically. That's this yellow icon there. A breakpoint actually means that whenever QFTest replays a test run, and if QFTest meets such a breakpoint, QFTest will automatically interrupt the test run and it will switch to the pause mode, and then we can go through that test step by step. So as I have set the breakpoint now, I would like to rerun the test case. But before rerunning the test case, we need to close the accessory dialog from the previous one, because our test case is actually taking care of opening that dialog. So I'm closing that dialog as well. Then I select the test case and I press start replay of that test case. After a couple of seconds, QF test will reach that breakpoint and it will automatically switch to the pause mode. Once we are in that mode, we can now run that input node, which was actually failing before, individually. Therefore, I do use the single step button of the toolbar in order to repeat that step. So I press single step, and we see it's actually taking a couple of seconds, which is actually a bad sign to us, because this means QF test could not determine the component, what we finally also got in our error box once again. If replaying this step had worked now, we would have faced a timing issue, and then we could solve this via inserting a wait for component node in order to wait for this accessory price field. The smartest way of inserting a wait for component node is to copy the input node and then to open the context menu and select transform node into wait for component. But unfortunately, here we have a situation where we don't face a timing issue. Here we have some troubles in the component recognition at all. So our next step is actually to record the component once again and to analyze what's the difference in those technical details which QF test is actually using to recognize those components. So I confirm that error box now. I'm also stopping the test run. And the next step is actually to, first of all, to focus on the old recording, on the previous recording. So I select that input node, I open the context menu, and then I select locate component in order to jump to the previously recorded component. And that's the text field accessory price component. Selecting this component enables us to set the so-called mark at this component. Therefore, I'm opening the context menu once again and I select marks, toggle mark, or later I will use the keyboard shortcut Control M to do so. I am marking this kind of component now in order to find the components faster in the next analyzer step. And the next analyzer step is actually to re-record the new component. So I press start recording, I select or I record a click at the price field, I stop the recording, I go to the newly recorded mouse click, then I jump to the recorded component once again using the context menu, locate component, and I'm setting a mark there as well. Right mouse click, marks, toggle mark. And what we see is actually that we see two blue dots, two marks. And this means to us that there has been a change in the component attributes which are evaluated by QF test in order to determine the component. If there were only one blue dot in our recording, then we would face a very strange issue in QF test and you might need to get in touch with the QF test support using the support email address support@qfs.de, where you need to send the run log as well as the test suite along with that mail. But in this case, we have a traditional, classical component not found exception and a typical situation having two dots, meaning that we have two components recorded. So the next step is that we figure out what's the difference. Where are the differences in those recorded components? Therefore, I select the old component. Then I'm selecting the new component. I'm going to select the old component again. I'm going to select the new component again. And I'm just doing that quite fast in order to figure out what could be the difference somewhere in those details. And if you do that a couple of times, you should see that the name of the component has changed. So we see in the old component, the name was accessory price. And in the new component, which we have recently recorded, we see the name is accessory price field. But as the name is a must-match criteria for recognizing components besides the class name, the name is not allowed to get changed in between versions and recordings. So this name is the reason why our component doesn't get recorded anymore. Our first step in case of such a name change is actually that we ask a development team whether they know why this name has been changed. The name is actually some kind of a technical property to those components, so the development team or the framework which is used in order to create that application has changed the name. If we were lucky, the development team could fix this naming issue, and in the next version we can then proceed with the previous name again. But in most cases we won't have this kind of lucky situation, and then we need to adapt the recording of our components. And the simplest and smartest way to do so is that you actually select the new name, that you copy that guy using the context menu and then select copy, then you go for the old recording to the previously recorded text field, and then you fix that name. So you change the old name to the new name, which you can simply do via selecting the old name and then pressing paste in the context menu, and so you have copy-paste the new name there. Then you confirm the change, and the old component has been updated successfully. In order to verify whether our change works as expected, we can now rerun the test case. Therefore, we delete the breakpoint, so we select the node which has the breakpoint from the previous one, open the context menu, select breakpoint on off. We also do close the accessory dialog because our test case is actually taking care of this. I select the test case now and I press start test run. The test case is running through without any errors. So we see in the bottom bar finished, no errors, everything is successful. We also see in the application our accessory has been created. So we have successfully resolved our first component issue. You can apply the same approach of resolving component properties also for feature and for extra features of those components if they got changed. So it's actually the same way. You take the new one, you copy it, you paste it to the old component. And this was the video of a simple case of resolving a component not found exception. The second video of our series will then handle a more sophisticated case where we have some changes in the component hierarchy as well.